you grow up with this feeling of baseball, and then at nighttime, you're sitting on the front porch with your dad, and they'd have the radio on, and you turn the radio on to Indians baseball, and you'd hear the announcer, 75 degrees in downtown Cleveland, Cleveland Municipal Stadium, Indians are playing the Tigers of Detroit tonight. You would hear that. It's all up here, son. He says it was sharp grounder to the shortstop. Shortstop flipped the ball to the second baseman who caught the ball, made a pivot at second base, and threw the first double play.
I think the history is there. I mean, the history is always there for the Cleveland baseball team. The Indians' history just carries over to the Cleveland Guardians. It just carries over. I mean, it's not gone.
And of course, today is officially the last game that we will talk about, this being the Cleveland Indians.
I guess we're in a new day of age where, you know, people have different feelings about certain things, and it offends people. We have to go on.
We're not mascots.
The use of Chief Wahoo as a mascot, it was offensive.
It's racist. It's time to move on.
The name has been part of Cleveland for, you know, a century. And then all of a sudden like that, it's gone. It was just like owner decides to change name, owner changed name, fans booed on the last day of the season when they said, we'll see you next year for your Cleveland Guardians.
Guardians? I hate it.
Bridge statues? Really?
Will you ever go to a game?
Nope. That's how bad they hurt me.
Change is hard, but change is necessary.
We came from thinking it's never going to happen, and then all of a sudden one day it happens.
And I'll look at the Guardians and take them for what they are our baseball team.
Name or no name, if you call them the Cleveland Clevelanders, they still represent a city that's loyal, a city that's passionate, a city that is very prideful.
It's a real traditional baseball town. And I think it will always stay that way, no matter what the name of the team is. Hi, I'm Jim Donovan. Three sports.
Okay, Jay Crawford, longtime Cleveland sports fan. That's my position in life.
I'm Leon Bibb.
My name is Gabriella Cruz, and I am a professional hype woman.
Joey Kinsley, and we'll say content creator.
Hi, I'm Justin Bibb, mayor of the great city of Cleveland, Ohio.
Ricky Smith, philanthropist, nonprofit guy, writer, comedian, Clevelander.
What does it mean to be a Clevelander?
It means being loyal, responsible. We are very loyal to a flaw because of our sports teams. What came first, the chicken or the egg? What came first, the Clevelander or the loyalty?
Well, we love our sports teams in Cleveland. It's embedded in our DNA and our psyche.
We are long sufferers. we know how to suffer.
Cleveland's a small city. People like to say Cleveland's a small, big city. Cleveland's a small city. We pride ourselves sports-wise with New York Yankees, Chicago Bulls. They have millions. We have 300,000. So with that said, we don't think of ourselves as a small city. With the George Jeffersons.
You're asking us to leave.
No, of course not. I'm throwing you out.
Might always get picked on, but yet it's prideful and he's not gonna give up. He's not gonna get that fight. We can beat up on our own city, but nobody else can.
It's so funny, like when you go around the country, people are like, oh, how'd you become like, you know, a Cleveland sports fan? And I was like, well, I mean, I was born, that was really important. Like I just, you know, existing kind of was an important thing, but that's it. Like you just don't have a choice.
In Northeast Ohio, if Cleveland sports fandom is a birthright, then a rite of passage is heartbreak.
In Cleveland, we had the Indians, and we had the Browns, and we had the Cavs, and it all added up to heartbreak and no championships until 2016. So the pain is real. It's real.
And until that 2016 NBA Finals victory, the last Cleveland championship was the Indians back in 1948. But the decades following, there's some dark days for the tribe.
Two pitch, and there's a base hit. Yes, Williams.
They went through so much losing.
Between 1960 and 1993, the Indians finished with an above 500 record only six times.
They weren't good teams.
It was losing, and it was losing in an ugly ballpark. But people were very proud of it.
I mean, my entire generation had never seen a good Indians team. I'm Jane Boyd-Esfazio, and I'm a huge Cleveland sports fan.
How long have you been a Cleveland sports fan?
My entire life. Anyone that knows me, I drive them crazy. I'm very passionate. Crazy almost. My first game I went to, I was in fourth grade, and I had won tickets. So that was like a thrill. And the players back there, like Gaylord Perry and Chris Chambliss, and I knew them all, I loved them all, Buddy Bell. I'd go down to the stadium and I'd go down by the dugout and try to get their signatures. And I mean, it was a huge part of my life. And my childhood, my dad would take me. Yes, me and my dad were, I was his little sports girl. And yes, he was a great guy. And he loved sports. 4 years old, he sat me down and I'd sit there with him, watching, and that's also part. I mean, I correlate my dad with sports.
I was amazed at the real core Indians fans, how they hung on to it, because there were some scary times. When I arrived in Cleveland, there was probably a higher possibility and maybe probability that the Indians were gonna leave. Everything broke when they built Jacobs Field. I mean, everything just turned around.
I love the Cleveland so much, I treat the water for the city of Cleveland. So the water you drink, I take care of that. That's how much I love Cleveland. Hi, my name is Danny Reichel, also known as Danny Cleveland. You gotta be everything Cleveland. You can't pick and choose. You can't be like, well, I'm a Browns fan, but I'm not an Indians fan. You gotta be all Cleveland.
Season ticket thing.
It's all Cleveland or get out of the boat. We got CLE stuff everywhere.
But here's the 90s team. We have the 90s players. So here's Sandy Alomar's game-used bat, Aaron Boone game-used bat, this Jim Thome game-used bat. This right here, it's a Jim Thome game-used jersey. He signed it, obviously, so you can tell he's my favorite player. Besides my children, this is my prized possession right here.
They do. Jimmy hits it high and deep to center field. Get out of here!
If the Cleveland baseball dark ages were the 1960s through the 1980s, then the 90s was its renaissance.
It was an incredible era.
These Indians are rocking.
It was timed so perfectly because this splendid ballpark opens up and it jolts the city with income and excitement and a renaissance of baseball. And at the same time, the team is great.
So great between 1994 and 2001 when Jacobs Field opened, the Indians went to the postseason 6 out of 8 seasons, including 2 World Series appearances. And not only was the team on an amazing streak, but so were the fans.
They sold out more than 8 straight seasons, every game, a Tuesday afternoon matinee.
Filling a void the Browns left in 1995.
It gave us a lifeline of something to hold on to as we waited for the Browns to come back to Cleveland.
They were like our savior. It was like, thank God at least we have the Indians.
This city's fan base was baseball bonkers.
But while the Indians were making baseball history, in the years that followed, another group continued to make their voices heard.
I don't look like that guy in a hat.
No, that's not trying to say you do.
Well, we don't like it.
Well, since the 60s, the Native community here in Cleveland has been voicing that opposition. This team name needs to change. It's racist and harmful.
I knew the name was going to change. I had no problem with the name changing. I agree with the name changing. Although I've always loved the Cleveland Indians baseball team, I found it somewhat uncomfortable, but we used it and it was accepted at that time. But as times change, you change with it. And names are important and words are important and how you describe people. are important.
My name is Joshua Hunt, and I'm a board member of the Lake Erie Native American Council. These mascots and team names have been around for a very long time, like since the early 1900s. They perpetuate harmful racist stereotypes, such as all Native Americans are violent, bloodthirsty savages who live in teepees, which if you look at the hundreds upon hundreds of Native American nations and cultures that exist just here in the US, that's sort of the equivalent of believing that all Europeans are French and the only European country that exists is France. So right out of the gate, these mascots and team names have been perpetuating those stereotypes since the early 1900s straight up to now. The physical sacrifice, the emotional and psychological sacrifice has been happening for over six decades. Over 100 Native American organizations and tribes have formally published statements. This is hurtful, this is harmful, this doesn't honor us. This does the exact opposite of honoring us. Racism honors no one, stereotyping honors no one. We don't honor people by harming them, and this team's name has been harming the Native American community for decades.
We always said, we didn't ever want to be disrespectful, but I think we found in 2020 that just saying that wasn't correct anymore.
How long this struggle has been going on, it probably will never happen. And then all of a sudden, one day, it happened.
We are excited to usher in the next era of professional baseball in Cleveland as the Cleveland Guardians.
Do you mind talking on that real quick?
So me, being a huge Cleveland Indians fan, I don't know how anybody doesn't look at that and think racist thoughts. That is probably the most inept depiction of an Indian I've ever saw. Like, I remember when I first saw that when they were talking about the 48 Indians, and I saw this version on the sleeve, and I'm like, yikes. You can tell the times have changed.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for taking time out of your day to be with us here for this special announcement at Progressive Field.
We are excited to usher in the next era of professional baseball in Cleveland as the Cleveland Guardians.
I think people were startled by it. It did come fast, you're right. I mean, we knew it was coming, and there were plans of it. But when it finally happens, there's a jolt of, okay, soon they're not going to be the Indians anymore. The ripcord was pulled, the decision was done, and everybody was just kind of left like, wait, what?
When you hear Cleveland Guardians, what was the first initial reaction?
Guardians? I hated it.
So, I wasn't mad that they changed the name necessarily. I was mad they changed the name to Guardians. They named it after two bridge statues. Like, bridge statues? Really?
Kind of shocking. And then I was mad.
The Indians were just something that we grew up with.
At the end of the day, when you funnel it down, it's an emotional attachment.
It was like a loss. It's like they took the team. I mean, you talk now with the Guardians, that means nothing to me. It's like, who are they? You talk the Indians and the tribe. Now, I mean, yes, instant memories come back.
Will you ever go to a game?
Nope. Because that's how bad they hurt me and made me mad. No.
We ask the question every day, what's new? Well, today the answer is the name of our baseball team. Going all the way back to December of last year, that's when the Indians ownership made the announcement they were indeed in the process of changing the name. And a lot went into that.
Yep. Hi, I'm Jason Wiedemann. I'm the Director of Brand Management and Innovation.
Hi, I'm Alex King. I'm the Executive Vice President of Marketing and Brand Strategy. It's been really challenging and rewarding at the same time.
Anytime you introduce something that's new and foreign, especially when you are changing the name of something that means so much to so many people, it's going to be very difficult, and we didn't take that lightly.
So we had a long list of names.
We had 1,200 names.
You know, most of those were not in real consideration. We whittled that down pretty quickly to about 20 to 30.
The process of whittling that down to one was exhaustive. Surveying fans and interviewing fans, looking for themes that they thought were important when it comes to the team name.
The legal process was the biggest challenge. The uncertainty, the time crunch, a really complex process, the roller coaster of we think that we might be able to do this and maybe not. We think we might be able to do this. You know, I think where we landed in Guardians, given all of that, I think we feel really good about it.
I think you could have done a better job involving fans to make sure that they felt a part of this a little bit more.
One of the key things that we were trying to balance all along the way was gather as much fan input as possible, but also maintain that confidentiality. We surveyed over 40,000 fans. We did over 1,400 hours of interviews with fans, employees, and stakeholders. And we did the best job that we could to hear that feedback from fans.
I think change is really hard all the time. Change of a name that has been around, have great memories around for 100 plus years, is really difficult. It's gonna take time.
I know that there are a lot of folks who don't agree with it. I know it's hard. Change is hard, but change is necessary.
They're not causing us harm anymore, and they're not perpetuating those stereotypes. They've made Cleveland a more inclusive, positive place.
I think what people are holding on is to memories they made with Chief Wahoo. There's memories tied to that character. That's why I believe it's hard to let go.
But here's the thing, I'll tell you right now. If we win a World Series as the Guardians, it's over. We're full on Guardians.
Winning cures all. They could be called the Cleveland Portageons. If they won World Series, people would have Portageons in their front yard saying, go Cleveland Portageons. Like, it's just winning. Winning changes the culture.
My sincere hope is that we all put it behind us. We all rally together, remember that? And we win a championship for this city. This city deserves it. We deserve better sports results than we've been given.
From Progressive Field in downtown Cleveland, Ohio, it's the 2022 home opener as tonight the Cleveland Guardians play their first ever game in Cleveland under the name Guardians.
It feels the same. Baseball in Cleveland.
It means family. It's what we grew up on with our kids.
You'd be hard-pressed to tell the story of Cleveland without talking about baseball.
Your first home game as the Guardians, how did that feel?
Felt the same exact way as, and not a bad way. I mean, just, you know, I mean, I'm proud that we have Cleveland on the front. That's what's really meaningful. I'm always proud to represent this organization. I was proud before, I'm proud now.
At the end of the day, this is Cleveland. I'm rooting for the three sports teams in Cleveland, whatever they're called.
They still represent a city that's loyal, a city that's passionate, a city that is very prideful.
We're excited about how do we build new memories with exciting new players and players that we have now.
He's a human tornado.
I look back and, you know, and I'll look at the Guardians and take them for what they are. They are our baseball team. I'll look back at the Indians and say that's a slice of history that went a long time. So you should never forget the Indians because it represented a lot of different things. I mean, it represented the first black manager, first black player in the American League, you know, a great renaissance of baseball. It's a real traditional baseball town, and I think it will always stay that way, no matter what the name of the team.